All right. Good morning, world. Hello and good morning. And thank you for rocking with us this morning on the Early Morning Sports Talk podcast. We have a very special show taking place this morning. And so, yes, we are back like a shark attack. We are back like we left some, back like we ain't got no clothes up on our back. And for the world is a better place when the Early Morning Sports Talk podcast is taking place. And so, all right, y'all. So thank you for tuning in with us this morning as we conversate about the latest sports topics that have taken place from this past week and will be upcoming this week. It is always a blast to have you all tune in and participate with us every weekend. As a reminder that every week, we always like to begin our podcast by reminding our audience that the Early Morning Sports Talk podcast can be found on Facebook, the Early Morning Sports Talk podcast community page, on Instagram, YouTube. As a reminder that every week we always like to begin our podcast by reminding our audience that the Early Morning Sports Talk podcast can be found on Facebook via the Early Morning Sports Talk podcast community page, on Instagram at the Early Morning Sports Talk Pod, YouTube as the Early Morning Sports Talk podcast, as well as Apple Podcasts, and on Spotify as the Early Morning Sports Talk podcast, as well as our own Facebook pages via Brandon Price, Jamar Goodman, and Peoples Hernandez. Today is November 19th of 2022. We have yet again seen another fascinating week in the sports world, where we saw the Tennessee Titans take care of a wobbly throwing Aaron Rodgers and Green Bay Packers football team. Yeah. Our Chicago Bulls go into a slump, and right now the Bulls are struggling and losing to the Orlando Magic. The Golden State Warriors continue to look out of sync. Kevin Durant publicly disrespecting the other four men starting alongside him from the Brooklyn Nets, as well as NFL Week 10 action. And this morning, y'all, we actually will talk about the World Cup, which begins tomorrow. And so just enough for our world, outside of the United States, right, Franc and Nadia, the World Cup is a big thing. The United States is kind of a big thing. We'll talk about that shortly, but not really. And so, yes, with that being said, Nadia, if you are ready, my sister. So introducing our guest for this morning, Nadia Borard. She is an avid soccer fan and World Cup lover. And she comes from the beautiful island by the name of St. Martin, but she resides where I reside in Guadeloupe. And so she comes as having experience in playing organized sports herself, like basketball, et cetera. And her knowledge from soccer comes because of her acquaintance with close associates whom play professional soccer themselves. And so Nadia is a close friend of one of my cousins in Guadeloupe. And when given her the opportunity to join the podcast, she was thrilled. And so this morning, the Early Morning Sports Talk podcast, want to introduce you, Nadia, and thank you for joining us. Good morning, sis. How are you?
Good morning. I'm great.
Good. I'm doing great. Thank you for joining us. We truly appreciate it. Additionally, introducing our other guest for this morning, Mr. Franc, or Mr. Francis, a name. Me and Franc, we go back to college. Franc is additionally a big soccer lover, and he holds it down for his African nations. And so, Franc, this is your second time joining the Early Morning Sports Talk podcast. But as you know, we've talked about it in advance about the World Cup, and you stated you would come on, and here you are. And so, Franc, thank you for joining us this morning, brother. How are you?
I'm doing well, man. I'm a little under the water, but, you know, I'll be okay.
Yes, thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me, Frank.
Appreciate it. Yes, and introducing my normal partner here on the Early Morning Sports Talk podcast, Mr. Ian Jones. Good morning, my brother. Thank you for joining us. How are you?
Pretty good. Blessed. How's everybody?
Pretty good, bro. Yes. And so let's get started, y'all. But we will get started this morning, world, with a World Cup video. And this video will just kind of introduce everything that is about to happen internationally and even within the United States. And so Franc and Nadia, I will go ahead and
Haya, 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 haya street. Up on the ball, I'll be the world on my feet. Hit every discotheque and ask it for me, yeah, yeah. I wanna party, party, 8 days a week.
I promise, you know. Everything, everything gonna work out. Every tomorrow, no matter what go down. I promise, you know. Gonna be sticking around. Every tomorrow, no matter what go down.
But what can you do? We navigate through all the rough and the smooth. Yeah, we got that rock and roll, that rhythm and blues. Yeah, yeah. I'm never blue if I am rocking with you.
I promise you now. Everything, everything gonna work out. Baby, tomorrow, no matter what goes down.
I promise you now. Gonna be sticking around. Every tomorrow, no matter what goes down.
So good morning, guys. I don't know about y'all. And bro, I'm excited.
Yeah.
I'm excited. Yeah. People might not be all that excited in the United States because, I mean, and if we had a Raw team, it'd be going up in the US. I'm telling you, Nadia. If we had a Raw team, it'd be turned up in the US. But I tell you what, and it's turned up over here.
Like, it is turned up over here. Yep, it is. It is turned up in the Caribbean.
Yeah. You know, and it's because number one, they're defending champs, France is. But additionally, you just walk around here right now, there's plenty of soccer fields everywhere and stadiums.
It's a Caribbean sport. Soccer is a Caribbean sport. Trust me, it's a Caribbean sport. All through the Caribbean. It's turned up right now for the World Cup. Everyone is tuned in. Everyone is putting the flags out. What color they repping, what country they repping. Yeah, it's a big thing over here in the Caribbean.
So, yes, world, welcome to the Early Morning Sports Talk podcast. We are talking the World Cup. And so, just curious, Nadia, you're our guest. Franc, you can chime in next. And then, Anne, you can chime in as well. I just want to know, Nadia, with the World Cup, which team, because it's like with soccer, we watch it, but we don't watch it like every day. A lot of people don't like that. It's so many games. It's a really big sport. But I'm curious, Nadia, out of all the teams that's in this World Cup, which team are you most, or which country are you most looking forward to watching?
Brazil. I looked at all the games, but I'm for Brazil. Brazil is my first team, and then France is second.
Okay, and so why Brazil? Why is Brazil so special?
They have good players. They have good players. They have good players over there.
Right. Such as Vinicius, right?
Yeah, Ronaldo. They have some legends from over there.
They got a great history of, you know, I mean, literally, I'm gonna tell y'all in the US, I don't know about you, Ian, but every time I think about soccer, honestly, I think about Brazil. That's just me. I always think about all the flashy players from Brazil, how crazy they are about soccer, aka football, and just how they really, really adore the sport. And so, you love Brazil. You think that what you know what? Why do you love Brazil? Is it because of like the talent? Is it because of the colors? Because people love teams because of colors. I know it's an odd question, but you know, like if you got the right uniform.
I like it because of the talent. They have great talent over there. The team colors are pretty nice color, but I love him because of the talent.
So you don't like the red, white, and blue colors?
Yeah, I do. I do like the red and blue, but Brazil colors are nice color.
Okay, I got you. Yes. All right. So, Frank, my brother. So, which team are you looking forward to watching within this World Cup?
So I'm looking forward to a lot of teams, but I think France is just too entertaining. You know, they have the world's best player right now in Mbappe. He won the World Cup last season, or last World Cup, and he was pretty young. He was not even like 22. So now he's experienced. He's been playing with a lot of Brazilian stars, so he knows a thing or two about them. And the one thing I like about France is, so obviously I'm biased. I'm African, so I love African players. And Nadia thinks soccer is a sport of the South America, but it's not. It's all Africa. But France has a lot of players from Africa, and so for me,
Yeah.
France is always my African country out of Africa. You know, so I'm gonna see how they're gonna defend this. Everybody's counting them out, but I pick France to go in all the way, and we'll see how it turns out.
Yes, that is so okay. So you're looking a lot out for France. I mean, they do got Benzema, right? Benzema's no scrub, right, Nadia? This dude
And
can
they have
play.
Mbappé.
Pogba's not even right. They got Mbappe, they got some of the world's greatest young talent coming up today, developed like the Golden State Warriors. Y'all know how the Warriors develop their talent, like the Mingas and the Kamingas and the Moody's. That's what France got in. They got kids now that's ready now.
Yeah.
They're strong, and they left us some really good players on their roster. I mean, Paul Pogba is like amazingly good, and he's not
Amazingly
on the roster.
good.
Yeah, so
So good, right, Frank? That if you ever listen to the song Joanna, Joanna's talking about Pogba in the song. I don't know if you ever heard it. And this is a really popular song. This is, you know, you hear it all the time over here, at least when it was popular. You hear it every day on the radio. And literally they talk about Pogba in the song. That's how good he is. And he's an African soccer player. And so, yes. Good morning, Prescott JB. Prescott JB stated if the United States treated football like football, you know, like so, if the United States treated football like American football, in other words, we destroy every country by a minimum of 10 points per game.
That's a strong wish. That's
Maybe
so
they'll be the
good.
surprise team of the season.
And
They
so
can bring
that.
the women team in. Maybe the women team can represent the United States because
The
they might
women's
do
team, as we know, is very good, right? Frank and Nadia, they're really good. They win a
Yeah.
lot in the women pool.
Yeah, the women's soccer for USA, they have been doing very great. They are great. They are better than the men.
A bit. They need to stop saying soccer moms and start saying soccer dads. Maybe that will turn things around, right?
Yeah. And so, yes, Ian, we come to you with this question now, bro. You know, there's a bunch of teams in the pool. Just curious, bro, which team are you most looking forward to watching in this World Cup?
Like you guys stated, I would say France, but also I would say Argentina too, with supposed to be Messi's his last run. So I think that would be pretty interesting.
Yeah. That's a really good one, bro, because this could be lying down Messi's last ride. And, this additionally brings me to who I'm looking forward to watching. And we're about to ask our other brother as well, as he chime in with us shortly. I'm mostly looking forward to watching Portugal. So I'm looking forward to watching Portugal because Cristiano Ronaldo is the international, y'all. He's the international goal scorer of all time. And this is highly rumored to well be his last ride as well. And so right now, Ronaldo and Messi out there looking like old men, but these old men are ranked, y'all. They like LeBron and KD. They still ranked at the high echelon of soccer players, even though they've been in the World Cup. Now, this gotta be Messi's what, third or fourth? Like, he's been playing a long time. Ronaldo still looking like he's 15 years old. This gotta be his third or fourth World Cup, and so I'm looking forward to watching Portugal. Ian is looking forward to watching. Argentina. Yep. Nadia is looking forward to watching Brazil. And Franc is looking forward to watching France. Jamar, I mean, I know you just joined us. Good morning, bro. I see you with your Bears background. How you doing?
Good morning. I'm hanging in there. How's everyone doing?
Pretty good. Morning.
So just bringing along this question for you, bro. There's a lot of great teams in the pool. And so as stated, we talked about France, we talked about Argentina, Portugal, talked about Brazil. Which team are you mostly looking forward to watching in this World Cup?
Whew. Man, like you mentioned, there's a lot of great teams out there. You all have great answers. I probably would choose those. I'm going to be contrarian. I'm going to just look forward to my team, the United States. I just want to see what they can do, see how improved they are. I just want to see if they can make it out the group at that point.
Right. Exactly. Yes. And thank you, Jamar, for taking that for the United States. Because Jamar, around the world, people are pumped up for the World Cup. In the United States, we're looking forward to NFL Week 11. That's what we're looking forward to. We're looking forward to NFL Week 11, Nadia. And we're looking forward to seeing what Kevin Durant, what happens with him. And we're looking forward to people trying to get into the college football playoff. That's what matters in the U.S. right now. The World Cup is like,
because we're not good.
Right. We're good. Them bars would be packed out. Them bars would totally be packed out. And so right now, United States got a young team, but let's actually get into this pool, y'all. And so it's a bracket, y'all, and I'm bringing up a bracket, y'all, because it'll just allow us to see what's happening, right? And so as example, the U.S., we are in Group B, and so we're with England, Iran, Wales, et cetera. Senegal's over here. Senegal got a really good player, Franc. I can't know the guy's name. It started with an S, but
it's Mane, M-A-N-E.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And they say he's dangerous. Senegal,
Senegal might have some surprising wins. Actually, they're a really, really good team. Yeah, I mean, they're the defending champs from Africa, Cup of Nations. So they definitely make another first round for sure.
Yeah. Okay. And so yes. All right. And so this World Cup bracket, y'all, I bring it up just so we can kind of see what's happening with the different pools, et cetera. And so now, y'all, We stated which team we would like to see win, but based off of what you're seeing now, I got to ask you, Nadia, I got to ask you, Franc, Jamar, and Ian, which team do you see coming out of this full bracket? You can break it down all the way if you want to. You can break it down so you think U.S. is going to shock Wales or Iran and go here, et cetera. And so, yeah, I'm just putting it out there, y'all. I think this is the year of – I'm going to go with Argentina. But that's partly because I've been trying my best to study. And so based off of what I've been studying, a lot of people like Argentina, but a lot of people like Brazil, and a lot of people like France, and a lot of people like the Netherlands. I don't know why, but they do. And so, just curious, Nadia, let's begin with you. You had to pick a champ for this 22 World Cup. Which team do you think will come out?
I think Argentina will come out to the top and Holland behind of them.
That's the final. Yeah, you told me that yesterday. Yeah.
I think the final will be between Argentina and Holland. Semi-final. I believe Brazil will get to the semifinals. France have a good strong team, so I believe that France and Brazil could be team up together. This is where I'm seeing it.
Right. So in this case, to break it down, fellas, if you look at this little bracket right here, sort of like the NCAA tournament, y'all. So what Nadia is saying is that although a lot of people like the Netherlands, she was saying Argentina would beat Netherlands somewhere here and move on here. She's stating that Brazil would win between this. She's stating that over here, France would come out. And she's stating that down here, got the other team, said another team. But basically, okay. And so in this case, no, Nadia, that it can't be a final between the Netherlands and Argentina because they would end up playing each other.
The same. Okay.
So you see this group F and group H?
Yeah.
And so Portugal's down here, Belgium, Morocco, Ghana, South Korea, Uruguay. Out of these teams, which do you think will come out of these eight teams?
Belgium.
Belgium's good.
Belgium.
Okay. So you can see Belgium beating maybe Portugal or Uruguay somewhere?
Yeah.
Okay. And then eventually your champion, well, in this case, you would go at Argentina. And so between France and Belgium, who would you pick?
France.
They would have to, okay. And so your final then in this case would be France and Argentina,
yeah.
Right. So fellas, y'all see how that worked?
Yeah.
Okay. And so a final. All right. We're going to post this on the page too, Nadia.
Okay.
It's like we post our NFL picks. Your World Cup final is France versus Argentina.
Yeah.
All right. So, Franc, based off of this bracket, brother, I know that you did yours and you posted it on the Early Morning Sports Talk community page. Mm-hmm. What do you see with this bracket? Who do you see as a champion?
Oh, yeah, let's go. So that first square bracket, Qatar, Ecuador, Senegal, Netherlands, I'm picking both Senegal and Netherlands to make out of that.
Okay.
And then in Group C, we have Argentina, Saudi Arabia, Mexico, and Poland. I want to say Argentina, Mexico make it up. Group E, Spain, Costa Rica, Germany, and Japan. This is going to be Germany and Spain. And then you got Brazil, Cameroon making out of the next one, Group G.
That's a tough one right there.
So next up, we have Senegal, Netherlands. Senegal will advance there. And then between Argentina and Mexico, obviously Argentina make it through. Between Germany and Spain, this is going to be a tough one. Germany will make it through though. And then between Brazil and Cameroon, Brazil will advance. Right. And then going next will be, so now we have Argentina facing Senegal, Argentina advancing, Mexico, and no, that's, who did I have there? That's Argentina, Mexico. Yeah, so next up will be Germany facing Brazil. Very good game there, right? And I think Brazil advances. So we have Brazil making it to the final from that side. On Group B, surprising news, USA and England will face each other in the next round. So they will make it out of that group. France and Denmark will make it out of Group D. And then you have Belgium and Canada advancing. Actually, this is a tough one. Maybe either Belgium and Canada or Belgium and Croatia. I think this is a really good group, actually. You know, all those teams are really great in Group F.
Wait, so Franc, I got to stop you. And Nadia should know this as well. Croatia, how you going to disrespect them? They made the final in 2018.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Croatia for the final. That's why I said this Group F is a really good group. I mean, that's a tough one. Actually, I changed my mind. I'm going to go Belgium and Croatia advancing here. But all these teams are really great. Even Morocco, you can't count them out. Belgium, Croatia advance here. And then between Portugal, Ghana, Uruguay, I think Portugal and Ghana can advance here. And then next up, so England will beat USA to go to the knockout stage of 8. And then France will advance against Denmark. Belgium, Croatia, man, that's a tough game. I think Belgium will advance. Yeah, they have a really good team. And then Portugal will advance against Ghana. And then England versus France. France will make it through. Mm-hmm. And then between Belgium and Portugal, which is also going to be a diehard game, I have Cristiano Ronaldo getting disappointed yet again. And Belgium is going to advance into the next series. And then here we have France and who do I think here? France and
France.
Surprisingly, France will make it through. And then France versus Brazil. And France is going to win the World Cup for the second round in a row.
Wow. So you got France repeating.
Yeah. Why not? Right. They can do it. Right. They did it before without experience.
Right. Wow. That's dope, bro. You broke that down.
Don't forget that France, one of their top players is not there in the finals this year as well, too.
They're that good. They don't need a good player because they're a good team. You know, they stick it together. They don't rely on one key star, which actually the World Cup has proven one key star doesn't win it all. I think it's the team, and I think their team is just too strong for everybody. And let's see how it goes.
Very interesting. Yeah. This is very interesting, man. Yeah. And that's a good point, Nadia, for bringing up that Pogba won't be there. But yeah, they are very, very developed. All right, Ian, bro. Just curious. Based off of this bracket, which team do you think will come out of the World Cup?
Okay, so it's tough to say which team I think will come out, but I think the two teams I'm going to the final would be Brazil, and I would say France for sure. And you know what? I'll be honest. I'll give it to Brazil with the upset because I think France is sort of like the favorite. Well, those two periods, so I would say Brazil.
Okay. Yeah. And so an FYI, and Brazil is the favorite, but France is like right there. And so it really ain't much of a difference. And so you got Brazil in this case taking down the defending champs and winning the World Cup.
Yep.
All right. We got Brazil. Jamar, bro, can you hear us?
Yeah.
All right. So just curious, bro. Do you have any thoughts on this bracket? If you had to pick a champion for the World Cup of 2022, and you know this kind of works like the NCAA tournament, and so you see how this all working, Jamar, like as example, you know, two teams would be 1A, 2B from here, et cetera. And so just curious, bro, if you had to pick a champion for the World Cup, who would you pick?
Ooh. Man, I'm going to just throw a wild card out here. I'm going to say Uruguay.
Uruguay. Okay.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, they always been tough to me. They always been right there. I'm going to just go on a limb and say they it's going to be their year.
Gotcha. And you know what? Uruguay, 2018-2014, they have made it to the final eight both years. And I believe in 2014, they made the final four. And they lost to, if I'm not mistaken, y'all, I think Argentina, who went to the final that year, and they lost to, I believe, Germany or somebody. But, yeah, Uruguay has always been tough, Jamar. I'm glad you noticed that, bro. They are very quiet, but very fundamentally sound. And so, yes, and so with that being said, y'all, Jamar has Uruguay, Ian has Brazil, Nadia has Argentina, I have Argentina, and Franc has France. And so, world, that concludes our conversation this morning for the World Cup 22 bracket. We highly urge you all to tune in and watch what will be a lot of great games. Me and Nadia, we both got our packages over here with BEIN TV, which means that we will be able to watch it. And yep. In the U.S., additionally, they will be watching it on ESPN. And it's going to be on right in Jamar and Franc at 2 in the morning. It's going to be on at 3 in the morning while people sleep.
Yep. Yep.
And they're going to look up and they're going to see the scores and stuff. And it's going to be happening basically throughout the whole day. And so, yes. And so, just curious, guys. Stop sharing this. Any final thoughts or anything, Nadia, Franc? About the World Cup before we move on to other sports. Just curious, Nadia, Franc, any final thoughts?
It's gonna be a tough game this year. It's gonna have a lot of surprises, I believe, this year in the, between the games. With a lot of political problems surrounding it, a lot of by cutting it. It's gonna be pretty interesting this year. I believe around the world, it wouldn't have the hype on the road like it had like years in the back because of the boycotting of many countries, is boycotting Qatar because it's hosting it, and the policies and politics behind of Qatar is going to have a lot of boycotting be going on. But yeah, it's going to be pretty interesting this year. I believe it's going to be very interesting this year. Suck the whole World Cup.
Yes, indeed, that's a very good point. Yes, Franc. Any final thoughts?
Yeah. Honestly, I'm looking forward to see how Qatar showcases its world around you know that region. We don't see a lot of Qatar in the news all the time, unless you know you go there frequently or are flying to other parts of the world. So yeah, I want to see the World Cup is all about the scenes and the drama and what's happening, you know, from game to game. So I want to see how Qatar does it and how they showcase their world around them. The other thing I'm looking forward to is how the expiring stars are going to perform. You know, that the Lionel Messi's of the world and you know they haven't proven it that they can perform in a country stage. They do well in the sports stage, where in the club stage, where they have a bunch of stars around them, and they've always, you know, showcased how good they are around really good players. But then when it comes to the representing their country, they don't have all that talent around them, and so they don't do so well when it comes to the World Cup. And they've done it year after year. They just can't advance far enough. So I want to see how they're going to do it, because this is their nail biter. This is their last World Cup, and they're not going to have another chance. And I think Cristiano, with all his drama, he's got something to prove, because he's been making a lot of noise for not being played in the Manchester United, games. So he's came out, you know, criticizing the team and saying they're trying to get rid of him. So he's put his himself, he's given himself the pressure to showcase that he's still good enough. And so we'll see how he handles that pressure. And then last thing I'm looking forward to is I want to see how my African countries do, man. They always like, they do so well first round and then second round, and then they die off. And I would love to have a big surprise from that continent, because it's soccer is so big. It's the one thing everybody wants to do in their life. So I hope they, Senegal or Egypt, because Egypt has that Mo Salah, who's one of the world's greatest scorer right now. And then his former teammate, Mane, Sadio Mane, he beat him in African continent. And so I'm sure they might be going at each other, try and prove that I'm better than you. So between Ghana and Senegal, I really want to see how far they can go this year. Hopefully they can carry the African flag and advance it far away, because the whole continent is going to lose their shit.
and you bring up a man, you know, hopefully it ain't going to be no biting going on due to World Cup, you know, no biting like Mike Tyson biting. That soccer field, it could get tough, and you start biting folks, man. You tired, you're running out there. And so just want to highlight quickly the four African countries. Two from North Africa, Tunisia, Morocco. They're all in different groups, y'all, if y'all saw. Mm-hmm. So you got one African team in Group B, which is Tunisia, one in Group F, which is Morocco. Then you got Cameroon, Group G, and then Senegal up there in Group B. So definitely looking forward to that. So
There's Ghana too. There's Ghana.
Ghana, yes, thank you, sis. Ghana is there too. Ghana is additionally there in Group H. So yes. And so Nadia, Franc, I hate y'all gotta leave us.
I wish I could stay, but you can hear it from my voice. It's scratchy and weird, and I'm gonna have to let you all keep going. Otherwise, I can't keep talking for another 10, 20 minutes.
Yeah, and so I truly appreciate it. Nadia, of course, we'll talk. Franc, of course, we'll talk. And so we thank you guys for joining us this morning on our Early Morning Sports Talk podcast, and thank you for helping us break down the World Cup.
Appreciate it, man.
Thank
you. Thank you for having me. I'm going to be online chatting away, so look out for my comments.
All right, great. Yes. All right. Well, thank you, guys. Appreciate it. Peace. And now, thank you, Nadia. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
So, yes, we thank Franc and Nadia for breaking down the World Cup, my bro, Ian. And so now, you know, we're going to go ahead and begin to talk about the American sports. And so, yes, bro, let's begin with our first and foremost. Additionally, we'll begin to probably share the video a little bit more so that other people can see it. But, all right, so NBA superstar, bro, Kevin Durant, he is clearly frustrated with this team situation, right? So after this week's loss to the Sacramento Kings, in which, y'all, the Brooklyn Nets gave up a damn near world record and scored of 153 points, KD stated this, y'all. He said, look at our starting lineup. Edmund Sumner, Royce O'Neal, Joe Harris, Nick Claxton, and me. It's not disrespect, but what are you expecting from that group? You expect us to win because I'm out there. And so, guys, curious on your thoughts on this. And how do you think this makes his teammates feel? Does this change the locker room, et cetera? So just curious, guys, what are you guys, Jamar, you know, you go and you chime in. I wouldn't want to be KD's teammate after this, bro. I'd want to be the, I'm in church. You know, I don't want to see what I really see. You know, like, just Jamar, bro, what's your thoughts on this? Like, KD could just be super blunt, can't he? Like, man.
Bruh. Yeah, KD has no filter. We know that by now. KD speaks what's on his mind, on his heart. He don't care. To a certain degree, I get where he's coming from to a certain degree, but I think it's just the way he went about it, how it went off. Because you know, like you said, he's blunt about it. So I do get it to the point where, you know, his starting lineup probably is lacking compared to other teams right now at this moment. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, like, y'all professionals. Y'all are professional athletes, the best 400 players in the world. I'm not trying to hear that. I'm really right. not. Yeah, and if I'm one of his teammates, dude, especially if I'm like Royce O'Neal, you know, that's been in the league for a while, or Joe Harris, who's been in the league for a while. Mm-hmm. Right, bro, I'll be, you know, like what's really good? Like, what are we doing? Are we trying to really compete together, or are you on your own agenda? Mm. So that's where I'm at on that.
Yeah. I hear you, man. Yeah, and your thoughts, bro. What do you think about this?
As a leader of that team, I just don't think that's something you come out in the public and say. I mean, if you have a problem with the team, I think you tell us head on, but I don't think you come out and say that in public. You know, you could just say, just we need to get better as a team and, you know, things of that nature. I don't think no leader, no past leaders have even said anything, you know, remotely close to that. So I think he was out of pocket for that. It could change the dynamic of that team. It seemed like they've been playing okay since that loss and with the new coach, Jock Vaughn. But but that was a pretty low blow, especially to come say that on the media.
Yeah, I'm with you, bro. I view it as just highly, highly disrespectful. Sometimes blunt, right? Like you're saying, Jamar, it could challenge the other players, right? And so as a leader, sometimes you're saying, okay, I'm going to be really blunt. I know that's going to piss them off, and then that's going to make them step up their game. And so that could have very well happened, or it could be F this dude, And so I'm just curious, fellas, this might sound crazy, Jamar, but do you guys think that KD is doing this so that he can possibly force his way out of Brooklyn and get himself traded to another team? And what do you guys think? Do you think he's trying to reunite with Golden State? I don't know. But Jamar, what's your thoughts, bro?
I mean, we just not going to ignore the fact the man requested a trade this past summer. So at this point, anything is possible. It really is. Like, maybe that is part of his agenda. Or maybe he just, you know, going through the motions, don't care, just out there just playing. And if they lose, they lose. They win, they win. I think at the end of the day, he just want to play basketball. I do believe his love for the game is, like second to none in that regard. But, I mean, I don't think at this point it don't even matter. He just wants to be, like, he just wants to play and be done with it. He don't care.
Right. Yeah. Do you think KD is trying to get his way out of Brooklyn so that he can reunite with Steph Curry and go to state? Or do you think he's just trying to get out of Brooklyn in general because of all the stuff that's been happening with Kyrie Irving, losing team, the new head coach, you know?
Tough to say. I don't think necessarily he's trying to leave to go back to Golden State, but I do feel like, you know, maybe he's not that interested in being there anymore. But it's tough to say. Like you say, he could have just, you know, said that to State to simply just, you know, get those guys to play harder. But it's another way to do that. I think that was the wrong approach. It's another way to do that. Now, we could be wrong on the outside looking in, you know. Those players could have responded to that, but, you know, I'm just on the outside looking in. I think that it could have been a different approach. I don't see him getting traded. Anything's possible, but I don't see it, though.
Right. So you're saying Brooklyn, they just going to hang on to him, and if he gripe, he just going to gripe. But they ain't going
to gripe. I think they pretty much proved that, and I think, you know, during the summertime, I think the Rudy Gobert situation kind of ruined him getting traded too.
Right. Factual, bro. Very, very true fact. Because I just brought it up there, y'all. There's rumors out there that KD, for our viewers, y'all, KD is trying to start drama in Brooklyn, say bad things, say outlandish things so that he can piss the organization off, so that he can be traded and he can reunite with Golden State and go win more rings. That is possibly down the road. And so right now, is that KD's motive? We don't know. But right now, we just know he's not happy in Brooklyn, and he is calling out everybody, including his starting five, his fellow four bandmates. And so, yeah, and it's not what you do, it's how you do it, right?
Yeah.
All right, bro. Let's quickly, before we get into the NFL reactions and overreactions, thus far this season, with what appears to be a waste of talents of Kevin Durant and Steph Curry, you know what? Actually, I got to frame that question. So with a waste of talent right now with Steph Curry, bro, who right now is having statistically his best season. James Wiseman of the Golden State Warriors just got sent to the G League, bro. James Wiseman. Kuminga and Moses Moody not looking ready, as we all expected. And then Klay Thompson definitely not looking like his usual self and looking like he's trying to get back into form as well. Why do you think the Golden State Warriors are struggling? Is it because of these reasons? Is it because of Draymond Green with the fight with Jordan Poole? Or is it just a combination of all these things? What the hell is going on in Golden State? They're supposed to be damn near 15-0, at least according to what everybody expected. What's the problem, man?
I mean, simply, you know, everybody else has to step up. I mean, Steph can't do it by himself. I think, you know, that bench, the bench just needs to step up, or they need to, you know, invest in a better bench. You know, they did win last night by 10. They beat the Knicks. I think Klay, I don't think Klay will ever be the same after taking those two major injuries. And it's possible that I think they should look into kind of trading or moving on from that big three. I think they need to start Jordan Poole. I think he needs to be a starter, and it's possible they could. I mean, it's possible. I think they need to look forward into moving Klay Thompson, because I don't know. He's not going to be the same after those two major injuries. I think they got a little bit of time with Wiseman, so they can kind of figure him out and kind of get him, you know, sped up. But he got to get it going. He got to get it going as well. But I think the main concern will probably be the bench. They need to invest in that bench, or simply just the bench need to step up. Like, this is the same team that won the championship last year, so it's not like it's a big change,
right?
Yeah, not like it's a brand new team. So I think they should consider or look into moving Klay. I wouldn't just go all out on them all yet, you know, but I would consider moving and starting Jordan Poole.
Right. Gotcha. Jamar, bro. Can you break down what is the problem at Golden State? This team won a championship last year. They are great. These young guys supposed to came in and be molded already. Moses Moody, Kuminga, Wiseman just got sent to the darn G League. You know, like, what is the problem with Golden State, bro? Like, why are they losing? What's the problem, man?
Man, I think money is the problem. I think money is the problem. I think, you know, Poole got the bag. Wiggins got the bag. Draymond ain't got the bag.
No, he don't.
He doesn't. I mean, we saw friction. Heck, we saw a knockout punch not too long ago.
Yeah.
I mean, Poole hasn't produced like he's supposed to. I mean, the bench itself, Klay, as, you know, Ian mentioned, it's to the point to where you wonder, is Klay going to be anywhere close to the Klay that we remember? And it's, you know, not looking good right now. It's not. I understand that, you know, ACL and Achilles, you know, usually take about a year to get ramped up back into form these days. But, yeah, I feel like you're not seeing any signs of that right now. So just all in all, like, guys are not performing to the expectations that we have or the team has. So maybe it is a good thing to send Wiseman down to the G League. Because, I mean, Wiseman hasn't really played at all in his NBA career. He might as well still consider him somewhat of a rookie. Mm-hmm. So let him go down there, get reps. 15 years ago, this wasn't gonna be a thing. There was no such thing as a top, you know, a lottery pick going down to the G League in development and coming back. It was either you sink or swim. If you sink, that was it. Look at
ask Kwame Brown. Ask Kwame.
Kwame. More recently, to beat. Remember him?
When second overall? Yeah.
He's
Mecca Okafor.
Oh. Why are you disrespecting the back of Okafor like that, man? that's bogus. but yeah, you know, the Warriors are probably one of the, if not the best, you know, developing team as far as young stars. So I give them a pass for now and just, you know, see how they blossom throughout the year. It's the vets for me that has to step up outside of Curry. Curry's been doing his darndest out here. Like Draymond, like money or not, like you're going to have to play. If you really want a contract, you're going to have to play because there's not going to be too many teams out there that's going to want you to begin with if you don't take what the Warriors offer you at the end of the day. The vets gonna have to step up in some way, shape, or fashion. I believe they will. Mm-hmm. And you know, if this team starts rolling all cylinders after the All-Star break, I tell you what, depending on where they seated, I'm pretty sure like gonna be a lot of teams that don't want to play them. So when it's all said and done, but for now, veterans got to step up, rookies got to develop some more, and all in all, like they gonna have to play together and not individuals. And leave the money, you know, that stuff aside, Draymond Green. So,
yeah, right.
They played good last night. They played as a team. Steph had 24, Draymond had 10, 9, and 7. You know, Clay had 20, Andrew Wiggins had 20, Jordan Poole had 13 off the bench. So, I mean, they played like the Warriors last night. So, I mean, maybe last night. Start
this
season, but we'll see.
Yeah, thanks for those stats, Ian. Thanks for those stats, bro. And by the way, y'all, going back to KD, Frank Noxie stated KD proved last season that he's not that great, and now he's trying to change that narrative and blame his poor performance in the playoffs on someone else. Yeah, KD, last season, he wasn't that great. You're right, Frank. In the playoffs, he got schooled by Jason Tatum. By Jason Tatum, who for me, Jason Tatum is a damn overrated scrub. Excuse my French, but he is. I'm just saying he is. Jason Tatum do not step up a lot. He bricks a lot. If he shoots better shots last year, y'all, the Boston Celtics beat the Warriors.
Yep, they went to the finals.
The Warriors. I know they went to the finals, but he still was bricking a joint up. They do well based off of Jaylen Brown, not Jason Tatum.
That's just me. Okay. And so, anywho, back to KD.
Oh, man. Yeah, y'all can go crazy on social media, etc. For me, Jason Tatum is overrated. He does have a higher ceiling, but he's overrated to me. That's just me.
But he's a top three MVP candidate right now.
All right,
top three
wait, you're talking about right now, right?
Yeah, they got a 9-game winning streak.
The Celtics, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I know the Celtics are great. Yeah, I get the Celtics, they kudos and all that. But as stated, he is still a brick machine, and he shoots a lot of dumb, ill-advised shots. That boy, like it'd be like, man, Jason, if you just be – y'all see what I'm saying, though? If he was more aggressive – the real tough moments, and he plays smarter basketball with his kid, and he could have been a champion already. But with his ill-advised shots and he hogs a lot. He hogs like he's Kobe, and he's just not Kobe. He's not Kobe. But he tried to hog like he's Kobe. I think it messes the Celtics up. Am I wrong for saying?
So I get what you're saying. So like definitely last year at times and in previous years, the shot selection has always been a question mark for me. But I think this year, I mean, I haven't watched too many Celtics games, but I think overall he's been a lot better. I mean, the man's averaging 30 on what, 40? I just had it. Sorry. Like 46% from the field, which isn't terrible. 38% behind the arc. No. That's not terrible either.
Bro, that is Jamar. That is great. And we are being schooled this morning, y'all, on Jason Tatum. Maybe Jason Tatum and I got it together with his ill-advised shot making, but I want to see a Jamar in when it counts. I want to see it in April, May, and if they make it to June, I want to see how that happens during the springtime. What are you doing in the spring, Jason Tatum? What are you doing in the spring? Not the winter, not the fall, the spring.
I mean, bro, you got to give him a little bit more credit. I get what you're saying, though. I have seen him play games, and, you know, he'll come down and shoot an ill-advised, you know, shot really in the shot clock. I think a lot of NBA players do that. So I was, you know, he proved it last year in the spring. They went to the finals.
So you got to. Yeah, they went to the finals and off a great team. They were passing the ball. That's why they went, because they were passing the ball. And what would slow them down when they lost was Jason Tatum. And excuse my French, y'all. Ass is for Bible and a donkey. I mean, Bible. But in the Bible, ass is for donkey, okay? And so his ass go right down the court and go shoot. And it's just like, you can't do that against Golden State. They going to feast on that. They going to eat that up.
Yeah, I agree with that. I mean, but I've seen Steph Curry do that. I've seen Klay Thompson do it. I've seen a lot of stars do it. So I get you.
Yes. And so, as stated, Jason Tatum, you are killing. Early Morning Sports Talk podcast, we know you putting up 30. Right now, you right there for MVP. Celtics winning a lot. But as stated, just in past years, and even last year in the playoffs, especially during the Miami series and during the conference finals, a lot of ill-advised shots. And those series ends were not supposed to go 7 games. They're supposed to be over 5-6 games if you shoot better shots. And so, Franc, you bring up a really good point. KD proved last season that he's not that great, and now he's trying that narrative and blame his performance in the playoffs on someone else. And so, KD, we'll see what you do, man. You calling out your teammates, calling the other 4 guys on your team trash, and then go play with them the next night. And so we'll see how that progresses. And so with that being said, y'all, let's now progress to the NFL to talk about NFL reactions and overreactions, because my boys Ian and Jamar looked at me like I was crazy when I said Jason Tatum at times is a scrub because he shoots crazy shots. But that's just me. All right, fellas, let's now move on to NFL reactions and overreactions. And so, Jamar, is it an overreaction, bro, to think that the Buffalo Bills can become a wild card team based off of how the rest of the AFC East is performing this season?
No, not at all. Definitely not an overreaction. I mean, we was talking about it the last couple of weeks, and it's come to fruition. Like, the Miami Dolphins, that Miami Dolphins team with that guy Tua at quarterback, the undefeated Tua at 7-0 this year, is on top of the AFC East right now. And then you have, who am I missing? The Jets. Jets are right there. New England isn't too far behind. Surprisingly enough, that's the best division in football. We didn't see that coming into the year. But nevertheless, it is a lot of competition in the AFC East, let alone the AFC in general. Because you still got Kansas City. You still got Tennessee. I mean, they just look like a very fundamentally sound football team that gets the job done. So yeah, it's not overreaction at all, man. Not at all.
Ian, your thoughts, bro?
I have to agree with Jamar. The AFC is pretty stacked right now. And like Jamar said, I don't think I don't think people seen what was coming, like, you know, like from teams from like the Dolphins, or, you know, even, I mean, even the Jets. Maybe the Dolphins because, you know, their acquisition of Tyreek Hill, but, you know, you got surprise teams like the Jets. You know, you can't really count out the Patriots and things like that that's always been there. So I think I would have to agree with Jamal.
Yep. All right, fellas, I agree with y'all too. AFC East is pretty competitive, man. Y'all, is it an overreaction to think that the Minnesota Vikings have now overtaken the Philadelphia Eagles as the best team in the NFC? Jamar, thoughts?
Yes, that's overreaction. It is. Now, granted, like last week, that game was probably the best game I've seen. And I went on record and posted, like, if those two teams between the Bills and the Vikings went to the Super Bowl, I wouldn't be mad. I'll be actually excited to see that game, by all means. However, look, the Eagles, I still feel like, is the best team in the NFC. Matter of fact, the Eagles beat the Vikings head-to-head, if I'm not mistaken, in week two or week three. Yep. Like, the Eagles are still a fully, like, complete team. They are. They beat themselves against the Commanders. The Commanders didn't go out there and just outplay them. It was more so the Eagles beat themselves with the turnovers and lack of execution. So, therefore, Eagles still the best team in the NFC to me.
Yes. The Eagles beat the Vikings 24-7. And so, Ian, your thoughts, bro?
Definitely an overreaction. Now I will say this. I think the Vikings have, you know, kind of made their point, as in, you know, we're just not winning games, you know, luckily, or we're just not getting by. We're actually a pretty decent team. So, you know, I'll give them that credit, but do I think they're on the Eagles? Do I think they're like the best team in the NFC or as good as the Eagles? No, but I don't think they're far off, though. You know, they're not, you know, they're not 7-1 for no reason. So I think they are a pretty good team. I just think they go as far as, you know, Kirk Cousins take them. You know, they have all the weapons in on defense, on offense. They have everything. It's just as far as Kirk Cousins take them. So,
right. I tell y'all what, fellas. If I had to see Philadelphia Eagles and the Minnesota Vikings based off of both of how these teams been playing, especially since how I see how tough Minnesota was against Buffalo in Buffalo, that showed me a lot about Minnesota, and a lot.
Yeah.
And so I would love to see both of these teams play in the playoffs. It'd be fantastic to see. Christ, all right, y'all.
That was the NFC Championship game. The year the Eagles won the Super Bowl when they beat Tom Brady.
Yes, exactly. Yep. Fellas, let's move on to another NFL reaction, overreaction. Is it an overreaction to think that Justin Fields, y'all, will receive MVP consideration if he continues to play this way throughout the rest of the season, even if the Bears are losing?
Yeah, man, pump the brakes. This is an overreaction. Mainly because – 3-7. MVP consideration is not coming for a losing team. I don't care how statistically and eye popping you are on film. 3-7, man, you're not winning MVP. Yeah. You're not getting any consideration. If it wasn't for that, then sure. If, you know, the team was like 6-3, 5-4, maybe. But 3-7? And after losing to the Lions? No. Nope.
Damn Lions. Detroit Lions. Like, those two games still hunt me, y'all. The Lions and the Commanders. You win both of those games, you're 5-5. You know, like, two winnable games that you just supposed to win, you know? Yeah, and your thoughts, bro?
Yeah, big overreaction. You know, I love the way Justin's playing right now. I love the love that he's getting, you know, from, you know, all the media outlets, but I don't really like the hate from certain people, and, you know, he's one of them, and, you know, Shannon Sharp made a comment the other day, too, but, no, I mean, we 3-7, I mean, like Jamar stated, nobody. I don't care if he's throwing for 400 yards a game. If we still losing, I mean, he can't be nominated for MVP. But, you know, hopefully we put some wins together. But, no, not yet. We got to pump the brakes on MVP. He wouldn't even get considered for Offensive Player of the Year, you know. So, we got to pump the brakes on MVP talk. But he's playing pretty good right now. So, hopefully he keeps up.
Right. If he keeps it up, though, I do put this out there. If he keeps balling the way he's balling, he probably can make the Pro Bowl.
It's possible. He can be a Pro Bowler. Yeah, possible. Very possible.
Yeah. So... yeah. All right, y'all. And lastly, no comment is required here, but is it an overreaction to think that Aaron Rodgers, the Green Bay Packers quarterback or Whackers quarterback, Aaron Rodgers, is full of himself after stating upon multiple losses, I won't bat against myself. I know what I can do. Jamar, what's your thoughts on this?
Hey, man, in the famous words of Aaron Rodgers, R-E-L-A, I'm playing, nah, this dude gets everything that's coming to him. Like, it's like, this is one of those, you know, he made his bid, now you got to lay in it. So that's where I'm at. I'm just loving seeing this team just self-destruct. So that's where I'm at.
Yes, go Bears. Yeah. Yeah, well, is Aaron Rodgers full of himself, bro? After saying it's like, what's up with him?
Yeah, man. I mean, like Jamar stated, I mean, you took the money. You know, Devontae left. Obviously, you know, they had a conversation before that last season started, you know, when they posted the Last Dance picture. So, you know, they both knew this was coming, even on his end as well. So it's just like, I mean, made the bid, you got to lay in it, you know. Exactly. They'll be fine. I just think he's getting older, you know. So, you know, he won't be young forever, you know. Father time, it defeats everyone. We've seen it, you know, with Tom Brady and, you know, some other great athletes. So, can't beat that. So, I think that has a part to play in it, too.
Right. Yeah. Yep. And so, y'all, that includes our NFL reactions and overreactions. And I'm also beginning with you as well, bro. Let's do our top five NFL teams. And so right now, for my top five NFL teams, number five, bro, I got the Buffalo Bills. And the reason why I got Buffalo is because of the loss to Minnesota and recently because of the loss to the New York Jets. I would hate to play this team, y'all, in January. Because they will be very well battle tested going into the playoffs. They'll be very well battle tested, Buffalo. And we already know what they can do, and we already know the expectations we have for Buffalo coming into this season. It's just right now, I think Buffalo is a recipient of a very tough schedule. But as stated, I think they might benefit them a lot, even if they're a wild card come January. On the other hand, the Miami Dolphins, I got at number four. Tua Tagovailoa, y'all. We had a debate, right? And we was talking about, you know, who's the top five quarterbacks. Deshaun Reed Sr. posted it. And, you know, people are like surprised that I picked Tua as like one of the top quarterbacks in the NFL. Like, this guy is 7-0 as a starter. Overall in his career, and when he starts games, even with Brian Flores, he won. The game that they lost a lot last year, he wasn't playing. They were playing Jacoby Brissett. And so... yeah. With that being said, I got the Miami Dolphins at number four. I think they are a very explosive and dangerous football team. Number three, I got the Eagles. The Eagles, y'all, beat themselves against the Washington Commanders. Jamar was dead on when he stated that. The Eagles had multiple chances to win the game, but I still give credit to the Commanders, and I still give credit to Ron Rivera in, because Ron Rivera is a great football man, has always been throughout his entire career. And those draft picks for the Commanders, it's paying off, bro. All the Jonathan Allen, all those guys, that stuff is paying off for the Commanders. But the Eagles still had a chance to win that game, multiple chances. And they just, you know, sometimes you lose. So I got the Eagles as the third ranked best team. Number two, I got the Chiefs. Even without Tyreek Hill, I think the Chiefs are more dangerous. It sounds crazy, but I think the Chiefs are more dangerous, bro, because they got more weapons. You ain't just got to key in on little number 10, but you got to key in on a few guys now. And so he's spreading the love, a great quarterback in Patrick Mahomes. And so the Chiefs are looking very good, man, and looking like the Chiefs of old. And number one, I got the Vikings, y'all. Now it's my best team in the NFL. After that convincing win over Buffalo, and after watching who I view now as the best receiving football, and I give you kudos, Jamar, and you guys told me at the beginning of the season, because I had Jamar Chase and Tyreek Hill above Justin Jefferson, you remember? But Justin Jefferson right now is looking like the best receiving football. And he looking like he could be all-time great like Randy Moss and be even better than Randy Moss. That's crazy. And so, yes, for me, I got the Minnesota Vikings, man, as my best team in football, bro. What's your top five, man?
My top five I got, man, it's crazy. This team was, man, it was top two all year, but I didn't drop them down to five. I got the Bills at five. I got those explosive Dolphins at four. This one was a tough one. I got the Chiefs. I got the Chiefs at three.
Okay.
And I got the Vikings at two. And I still got the Eagles at one.
Oh, wow. You still got the Eagles as the best team in football. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. That was pretty tough, but those would be one and two right now for sure.
Right. Gotcha, bro. Yeah. Yeah. Jamar, bro, who's your top five in the NFL?
Number five, I got the J-E-T-S, Jets.
Yay!
They still get it done somehow, some way. I'll leave the Disney Channel quarterback, Zach Wilson, alone right now. Number four, I got Tua and those Dolphins. I mean, Tua's undefeated as a starter, 7-0. It just makes you wonder what the record would be if Tua played every game this year, right? Dude, when they added Bradley Chubb, just added a whole nother dynamic to their pass rush. Mm-hmm. I mean, we see what weapons can do to a quarterback when it's being questioned. So, hint, hint, wink, wink. Ryan Poles, give my man some weapons here. Number three, I got the Philadelphia Eagles at three right now. Matter of fact, I digress. I got the Minnesota Vikings at three. I'm sorry. I got the Vikings at three.
Okay.
I got the Vikings at three. Look, I mean, Kirk Cochains, he's still doing his thing, and I leave it at that. Number two, I got the Philadelphia Eagles. And then number one, I got the Kansas City Chiefs. Somehow, some way, that team is, like Brandon was saying, even more dangerous without Tyreek Hill because it's forcing Patrick Mahomes to utilize every weapon possible. And he's getting the most out of everybody, which, and therefore, everybody's dangerous. So, Chiefs one, Eagles two, Vikings three, Dolphins four, Jets five.
Yeah. Yes. Patrick Mahomes over there spreading the wealth, man. All right, y'all. Well, let's talk about college football. No picks required. We're just going to notify y'all of a few games that's going on this weekend, a few big games. And next week will really be fantastic because next week is rivalry week. But right now we are in week 12. And so 7 USC at 16 UCLA, Big Pac-12 showdown going down. Another Big 12 showdown, Pac-12 showdown, 10 Utah, 12 Oregon. Pac-12 has been a great conference all season, y'all. And looking forward to both of these games. Illinois, y'all, unfortunately, we beat them last week, Jamar, Purdue. And then they lost to Michigan State as well the previous week. And so Illinois right now on a two-game losing streak, but they going up at number three, Michigan. Illinois has a Heisman-based running back. And so you got ESPN analysts, y'all, that's saying watch out for this game. Watch out for this game. Michigan could be in trouble. And so look out for this one, y'all. Illinois at number three, Michigan. 22, Oklahoma State at Oklahoma. Boston College at 18, Notre Dame. So shout out to the brother at Notre Dame. Honestly, y'all, when he took that job and I saw him losing in, I'm like, damn, another brother, man. being a scapegoat. You know what I'm saying? Another brother finna lose. Another brother they finna look at. Or we're losing because we got a black guy behind, you know, our organization and stuff. And so he has really changed that narrative. They have begun to win. They have begun to win and be on fire. And they looking like the Notre Dame we expected. And so Boston College today at 18 Notre Dame. And then lastly, we always like to highlight the HBCUs here on the Early Morning Sports Talk podcast. And so Jackson State University matched up today in Mississippi at Alcorn State University. So with that being said, y'all, let's now move on to our NFL Week 11 picks. All right. Got some big games going on this weekend, fellas.
Hey, really quick, I need one of you all to write down the picks this time.
Okay, gotcha. Okay.
You write them down, Brandon?
You know what, Ian? If you could, that'd be great.
Okay, I'm going to type them up on my phone. All right, sir.
Okay. Appreciate it, bro. And so with that being said, Jamar, you ready?
I'm ready.
All right, bro. Yeah, I'm playing the Falcons. All right. This is a 50-50 one. All right, Jamar, who do you got for this one, bro? You got the Bears or the Falcons?
Yeah, you're right. This is a 50-50 game. I expect our former Bear Cordero Patterson to score a touchdown in this game. I feel like it's going to be a revenge factor on that one. Ryan Pace is part of the front offices of the Falcons these days. But I'm gonna take the team with a better quarterback right now. I'm taking our boys. Because we've been scoring 30 points a game here. I don't know if the Falcons can keep up. I know our defense will probably give them a chance to keep up. But at the end of the day, I got to ride with our boys, especially in a 50-50 match. Bear down.
Yeah. And, bro, who you got?
So every time I pick the Bears, they find a way to lose. And when I don't pick them, they find a way to win. Last time I didn't pick them was the last time we won. So, but I want them to win so bad because I'm sick of going crazy every Sunday. Oh, man. I'm gonna say the Bears, man. They're gonna beat the Falcons.
Yeah. For y'all, man. I feel the same way. Every time I pick the Bears, they lose. It's often at times when I just pick teams, they lose. And so, I hope I'm the Bears' good luck charm, and I'm gonna go with the Falcons. Not because I think the Falcons are a better team. The Falcons could be a better team. They are just so volatile, right, y'all? One week playing good, the next week, you don't know what the hell happened to him. So when I look at the Bears from a standpoint of how their offense is playing, the Bears' offense is virtually unstoppable right now because you got to worry about Chase Claypool and Mooney going down the field, and it frees up Cole Kmet, and it definitely frees up Justin Fields. You know, Mariota's no scrub. He plays very similar. He can run. He can pass. Cordell Patterson is a nice guy. This will be a very good football game. I'm going to go with the Falcons just because they're at home, and I think our defense is just whack. So they can't stop a park damn car. They can't stop nothing. So, yeah. I'm going to go with the Falcons, man. I hope the Bears defense don't let the Falcons of all teams look like a great team like they did Detroit last week. All right.
Cal, that's a big day. What?
Yeah, I hope so. And so, Jamar, bro, the Browns at the Bills. Not live in Buffalo, but live in Detroit. Who you got for this one, bro?
I do want to let y'all know, like, NFL is weak for this. Yeah, they super weak. I wanted that game to be played.
Oh, yeah, man.
Yeah, this is weak.
It's so nice to watch. I hope there ain't no trend that, man, when it start to snow and stuff. Oh, let's just go inside. Like, come on.
Yeah. That's pretty whack.
You lame, man. Anyway, I feel like this is about to be a bad luck game because they playing in Detroit. We know how that goes. as far as this matchup here, Bills should win. Even the Bills are their own worst enemy. That's probably why they got three losses now. They're their own worst enemy. They beat themselves. That's how they have three losses. I don't see them beating themselves against the Browns. Otherwise, they lose to the Browns. You can have a semi-panic mode here, but I don't think it's
real.
I got Bills
mind. Yeah, it's a good point. And I mean, Jamar, they lose tomorrow, baby. It's semi-panic mode for real. Ian, who you got for this one, bro?
I got Bills Mafia. Bills Mafia.
Yeah. I'm gonna roll with y'all. I got the Bills as well. And this just leads more and more to me being ready to see what Deshaun Watson can do with this team in this last few weeks, which is coming up in the next few weeks, about three more weeks. All right. The Panthers, y'all, at the Browns. The Panthers, y'all, are still in the running for the NFC South. Do they get it done tomorrow in Baltimore, Jamar?
Starting quarterback is Baker Mayfield this week. Baker freaking Mayfield against a Baltimore Ravens team that he is familiar with. Now, I don't think he had much success against them, but nevertheless, he's familiar. Yeah, I'm taking Baltimore, man. we got the Ravens.
And what you got, bro?
Ravens. Easy.
Yeah, I'm with y'all. I'm going to roll with the Ravens as well in this one. The Lions, y'all, at the Giants. This could be a trap game for the Giants. I mean, the Lions don't have the prettiest record, but they got a pretty offense. Jamar, who you got for this one, the Lions or Giants?
Just the fact that the Lions have a winning streak here is blasphemy. But, man, the Giants been playing within themselves. Giants haven't done anything crazy this year. Giants are a fundamentally sound football team. I'm taking the G-men.
Yeah. And what you got, bro?
I'm going Lions.
Okay, you got Detroit. Why am I surprised? And y'all has picked Detroit for the last 2 years on the early morning sports talk.
The last 2 years.
there's nothing new here about this at this point. He picks them every single week for the last 2 years on the Early Morning Sports Talk podcast. He's picking Detroit Lions.
I mean, but
why should I be?
Hey, but in the same time frame, you picked against the Lions, so we know your pick by default, though.
You are totally right. Give me the G-men, please. Yes. I think it's a good football game, and I think it's a dangerous football game. We all know that.
Yeah,
we all know this is a bit, the Lions can win this game, real. But I think it comes down to the fourth quarter, and I think that Giants defense, and that special front seven for the Giants, I think they step up and get it done in a very, very close game to probably come down to the final drive. But I'm gonna go with the Giants. Jamar, good one, man. The Jets at the Patriots tomorrow. Who you got?
Man, the last time these two teams played, the Patriots, they snuck them, man. The Patriots got them. Got them good, too. So I think Mr. Sala collecting receipts this year. I don't think he forgot about that. I'm taking the J-E-T-S. Jets, an upset. I think it's an upset.
Yeah, and who you got, bro?
This would be a real competitive game. Oh, no. I'm going to go Jets.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to this game as well. This is a tough one for me, but I'm going to go with the Patriots at home. I think the Patriots pull this one out late. Jamar, the Commanders at the Texans. Do the Texans pull off an upset at home?
Hey, man, Kirk O'Kane Jr., a.k.a. Taylor Heineke here, Mr. Heineke, has put the team on his back here. And the fact that Stingley Jr., he's not playing tomorrow, I expect McLaurin to have a big day. Therefore, I think the Commanders are actually just more
better team.
Yeah, So I'm going with Commander Heineke in this one.
Right, right. And who you got, bro?
I'm going with Riverboat Ron. Prayers out to his family. I know he lost his mom last week.
For me, y'all, yeah, I'm gonna roll with you. I'm gonna go with the Commanders. Tyler Heineke, man, low key, he's been a winner, Jamar, since he's been a starter in NFL. He wins a lot. He hasn't had like much of any nationally publicity type games, but you know, he's no superstar quarterback. But you know, when he plays, he wins. And so,
dude, he reminds me of Shane Falco off the movie The Replacements. That's the best way I could put it.
That's my
homie. Oh, that man, Shane Falco.
Yeah. That's a good comparison, bro. Got the Commanders in that one. By the way, man, see what Davis Mills do. I don't know what Lovey's doing, y'all. I just want to point this out quickly. I don't know why he keep riding with Davis Mills. Davis Mills he sucks. Like, why do they get him? Like, just give somebody else a chance at this point. You're not going to the playoffs.
Davis Mills isn't bad. I would love to see, you know, him. They have a exceptional, a nice running back over, a nice rookie running back. So I would like to see them get more. But I don't think he's terrible, though. I don't think he's terrible.
Yeah, there's definitely worse quarterbacks in the league. He's definitely not the greatest by any means, but I mean, at this point they in line for the number one pick, might as well just write it out and get the number one pick, get you CJ Stroud or Bryce Young or whoever. Like, it's gonna be like three quarterbacks going in the top five next year. Get you one.
Right. Yep. Speaking of riding things out, the Rams aren't riding anything. The Rams are riding a losing streak. And they are riding a Super Bowl hangover, and they are 3-6 with all that talent on paper. And they are up against another disappointing team and another team that's a head scratcher for me, because this guy, Mr. Allen, he is riding it out with Mr. Rusty Rifle, seems like. At this point, I don't know if Jameis is going to start anymore, y'all. He is legitimately second screen, and they riding the Rusty Rifle, Jamar. And so do the Rusty Rifle get it done against a Rams team that is not only not playing Matthew Stafford as of late, I mean, he's hurt, but Cooper Kupp is hurt. Who wins this game tomorrow, y'all?
Hey, your favorite quarterback, Stafford, is going to play. But yeah, there's no Cooper Kupp. There's no Kupp, and therefore I'm gonna have to go to a fight with a Rusty Rifle. I'm gonna have to. I don't trust the Rams. I just don't. Matter of fact, I don't trust the Rams, especially without Cooper Kupp. I don't know what he's gonna do. He has a love affair with Cooper Kupp. He throws in the ball all the time. Like, he's not familiar with Allen Robinson. Maybe Allen Robinson get like 10 targets, or maybe he just get one and just throw it to everybody else. I don't know. Either way, I'm taking the Saints. I gotta roll the Saints at home. Yeah, it's a pick me game. I'm taking the Saints.
Yeah, this is a hard game for me. Ian, who you got, bro?
I don't like the Saints, but I do respect their roster. They have a couple of my favorite players in the league. But they've been injured all year. Saints been injured all year. The Rams, they just on the Super Bowl hangover. It's nothing less, nothing more. Super Bowl hangover. I'm gonna go Rams though. I'll go Rams.
Yeah. For me, I'm gonna go, Lord, I'm gonna go with the Saints at home. Allen Robinson, whatever happened to him, y'all? He does not look like he fit in with that Rams team, man.
Because they just, we could have kept him.
Yeah, pretty much. Because he fit in with us a lot better than he do with the Rams. You know, like, he don't even get the ball, really. and you know, when he get the ball thrown to him a lot, he's dropping a lot of passes. So it's a bad mix of chemistry between Allen Robinson and Matthew Stafford. And I noticed that y'all week one. And so it has not changed. They got 3-6. But I'm going to go with the Saints at home. I think the Saints actually have a better team if the Rams ain't got Cooper Kupp. I'm going to go with the Saints. The Eagles, y'all, at the Colts. So, Jamar, Jeff Saturday make it 2 in a row. Do we go 2-0 as a head coach in the NFL?
And not on a Sunday. I got the Eagles. Fly, Eagles, fly.
Yeah, who you got for this one, bro?
Fly, Eagles, fly.
Yeah, I think it's a competitive game, but I got the Eagles. The Raiders, man, oh, man, talk about two disappointments. Talk about two disappointments in the AFC West, which prior to the season, y'all, we was all over the AFC West as being the best division in football. And now it's looking like one of the worst divisions in football. The Raiders, you got the David Carr crying at the podium, man. You got Devontae Adams saying, I ain't feeling no remorse for nobody. And he playing football. You got Chandler Jones, y'all, who can't hit a parked car. This is just sad. Chandler Jones, Pro Bowl defensive end, can't hit a parked car, Jamar. Car just sitting there parked, and he can't even hit the car. Fall to the ground before he even hit the car. Like, this is bad. This clip, man.
Oh, man.
I'm taking this clip. Can't hit a parked car. I'm for the
look, man, on top of that, Russell Wilson, man. Russell Wilson can't throw the ball. He talking about ride. What? How the statement go, Jamar? With the Broncos?
Bronco country. Let's ride.
Right now, ain't nothing riding. The horses ain't being ridden. Ain't nothing being ridden right now in Bronco country. If anything, they look like they scatter horses. They running from the horses. So I don't know who win this game. Jamar, but somebody got to win unless they tie. And so who you got for this one, the Raiders or Broncos?
Man, the only thing worse than Bronco country, let's ride, is the whole debacle happening in Las Vegas. That team is atrocious. It comes back to Josh McDaniels for me for the Raiders. I can't do it. So therefore, just like the beginning of the year, let's ride. We riding this week. We ride.
Buckle up this week.
You got to stretch for that one because it's been so long, you know. It's been a long time. Ain't trying to pull a shoulder doing that motion. Jeez. Stiff back and all, but we riding this week.
Hey, Ann, man, who you got for this one, bro?
Hey, I'm had to ride my boy Jamar, man.
Hey, man, there's more room for you, Brandon, if you're trying to hop on, dog.
Hey, man, look, we've been saying this, y'all, for a while on the Early Morning Sports Talk podcast, that Josh McDaniels is better as a coordinator, not a head coach. Had a 16-year-old that came on last week and said the same thing. I'm just curious, y'all, if the Raiders lose this week, are you still confident? Like, if you're the owner, Jamar, and y'all sitting there in the box office, you know, you sitting there watching your team, and you are 2-8, like, are you really confident in bringing him back next year? Because they tried, you know, of course, Las Vegas is screaming. They were screaming that 3 weeks ago. Remember, y'all? 3 weeks ago. 3 weeks ago. I'm holding up for. I don't know why I'm holding up for. But 3 weeks ago, they were screaming, fire Josh McDaniels, fire. Now they're 2-7, okay? And it keeps getting worse. If this team is 2-8, I just don't know how you just go say to the media, we are confident with our head coach, Josh McDaniels, and we are bringing him back. I just don't know how you do that. But the owner went out there, silenced everybody for now. Although if he loses, you know, he go 2-8, the media should just start looking like, why is he lying to the people? Like, stop. No. And so for this one, y'all, I'm going to go with the Broncos just because the Raiders are reeling. But the Raiders, you got an opportunity to try to get a nice win tomorrow. You know, and be at least tied with the Broncos for the division lead at the bottom, you know? So that should be the goal, you know? I'm going to go with the Broncos. The Bengals, y'all, at the Steelers. What you got for this one, Jamar?
This one's a little intriguing to me. It's a little bit intriguing. I'm taking hashtag who day. But I don't think it's going to be as easy of a win on paper. I just don't. Steelers always get up for the Bengals. They do. No matter how mediocre they look or how bad or how good they look, they always get up to play the Bengals. So I just feel like the Bengals going to make less mistakes than the Steelers. Steelers defense is actually a little bit more healthier these days too. So I'm taking the Bengals, but I don't have the warm and fuzzies on this one.
Action. Ian, bro, you got the warm and fuzzies on this one?
No. Do you guys know if Jamar Chase is playing or no? He's still out.
He's out. He's ruled out.
He's out.
Still out. I don't know. Like Jamar said, this is a tough division game. It could go either way. But I'm gonna go with Joe Cool. I'm gonna go with the Bengals.
Yeah, I'm with you. I'm gonna roll with the Bengals as well. I think the Bengals are a better football team, and you know they got more talent. I'm gonna go with the Bengals. This is a good one, y'all. The Cowboys, man, you know Green Bay got that win last Sunday, and you know a lot of it was because of questionable play calling or decision making by Mike McCarthy. But they could have easily won, or they could not have easily, but they could have won the game against Green Bay last week. They are going up against another tough opponent. They were in Green Bay, now they're in Indianapolis, y'all. Who you got for this one, Jamar? The Cowboys or the Vikings?
No, you said it right initially. They could have easily won that game because they was up 14 points in the fourth quarter. They gave that game away.
This is factual. Thank you for that. Yeah.
No, this here is a perfect storm. This is one of those to where the Cowboys realized they gave up a game, so they're motivated. And the Vikings came off a thrilling win, so I think they're too high. I think the Cowboys actually comes in and smack them around. I got them boys this week.
And who you got for this one, bro?
The Cowboys. The Cowboys. It's that time of the year.
Most wonderful time of the year. And so, yeah, in this case, Ian, y'all, he got the Vikings. Because yeah, Ian liked to call the Cowboys the Cowgirls. And so, yeah, he got the Vikings. You know what, Ian? I'm going to roll with you. I'm going to take the Vikings. Cowboys, this is a tough game, man. This is going to be a physical game, a really good game. The Cowboys are 6-3, but they are a really good team, world. This is heavyweight fighting right here. I'm going to take the Vikings, though, man. I'm really interested in watching this game. There's so many stars on the field, so much talent, two explosive teams. Get your popcorn ready for that one. But I'm going to take the Vikings at home, although the Cowboys can very well win that game. The Chiefs, Jamar, they are at the L.A. Chargers. And my Chargers, whom I had as a Super Bowl pick, y'all, going into the season, are 5-4. They got some ballers on the Chargers. Don't get me wrong. Got some pro bowlers, some all pros. But they're just not winning a lot. Not like I expected them to. I thought they would be first place in the AFC West. But now they're not. It's the Chiefs. And so, Jamar, for this AFC West showdown, who you got, bro?
It's funny because we all had different teams being on top of the AFC West, except for the Chiefs, and yet Chiefs are just dog-walking the division right now.
Yeah.
I got Kansas City, man. I mean, it's Patrick Mahomes. We know who he is. He's the MVP right now. I'm taking Patty Mahomes, man. I don't think the Chargers keep it close right now. I just don't. Chiefs.
Ian, who you got, bro?
Chiefs.
And for me, I'm with y'all. I'm a roll with the Chiefs. I want my Chargers to put up a fight, man. This will be a very, very interesting game. Very fun game. It's in L.A. It's in L.A. Again, it's in L.A., which means that LA will have a chance to win this game for sure. I think this is a very tight game and it comes down probably to the fourth quarter. But I'm going to go with the Chiefs. I think the Chiefs pull this one out in a very good football game. I am watching that one. And lastly, y'all, Monday night, 49ers at the Cardinals. Talk about another disappointment, Jamar. And Cardinals, man. You know, I know Robbie Anderson just came in like 4 weeks ago, but you know, I expected when he came in, that would really help unleash their offense. But they're 4-6 and disappointing. You know, you got James Conner who sniffs the end zone all the time. He gets a lot of touchdowns. You got, you know, Mr. Hopkins back. You got Kyler Murray. Zach Ertz is out now, fortunately. But this is a lot of talent for the Cardinals, and they're 4-6. But the 49ers right now, they are kind of on their roll since they got Christian McCaffrey, and they look like they can just give the ball to anybody. I'm curious, for this one, who do you got? You got the Cardinals, Jamar, bouncing back and showing us that, hey, we are really good with all this talent we got on paper, or you got the Niners who are hot?
Man, I was looking for my Xbox controller so I can play Call of Duty with Kyler Murray real quick. But in any event.
Y'all didn't get that.
But in any event, I mean, Cardinals, who I thought they were the whole time, they are exactly who I thought they were. Some frauds this year, some super frauds. I mean, offense looks better this year. I mean, with DeAndre Hopkins now, but I mean, it's too little too late for me. It's the Niners game. Niners game. Niners game.
Yeah. Ian, who you got, bro?
Tough game. I'm going to go with my Cardinals. I'm going to go with my boy Kyle.
Oh, you got the Cardinals in another. Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah. I don't know what y'all think, world. 49ers and Cardinals, but for me, I'm going to go with the Niners in this one. The Niners, man, when we knew they got Christian McCaffrey, we knew that things were going to be unleashed in San Francisco because we knew they already had a great team without him. And then adding him there just made it, like, you know, even more options offensively. And so all our boy dude, Jimmy G, your best friend, Prescott JB, all he got to do is just get rid of the ball because he got so many options. He ain't got to hold the ball. Just get the ball to CMC, get the ball to Ayuk, get the ball to Debo, you know, get the ball to George, let him roll. And so we was talking about a team that you wouldn't want to play, let's say if the Bills got in the wild card, And they came in as a wild card, and you'd be nervous as hell. Like, we got the Bills. I know they're a wild card, but we got the Bills. Might be the same thing with the Niners. If the Niners don't win the NFC West, but I think they will. I think they got a really good chance, y'all, to overcome Seattle as the season roll. But if they were a wild card team, I would not want to play the 49ers at all. And so I'm a roll with the 49ers, fellas. And so, yes. Fellas, wow. So I see you, Jamar. You got Call of Duty. You playing with Kyler Murray right now?
Yeah, man. He's actually killing it out here. That explains why he's better on Call of Duty than he is on the football field. Sheesh. Let me put the controller down, man. He's killing.
Oh, my side hurt, man.
Whew. He's too good, bro.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. Hey, man. And so, yes, Kyler Murray, man, I hope you got the memo. You out here playing Call of Duty, man, and your team out here stinking up the joint with all these great people they got on their roster. And so, yes, well, that concludes our NFL picks. And so, as a rewind, y'all, as a rewind for our viewers, we began our podcast this morning by talking about the World Cup. The World Cup begins tomorrow, and we made our picks. And so Nadia and Franc joined us this morning. Nadia, she believes that Argentina will come out with the World Cup. Franc believes that France will come out with the World Cup. I believe that Argentina will come out with the World Cup. Ian believes that Brazil will come out with the World Cup. And Jamar has a wild card of Uruguay, which he believes will come out with the World Cup. And Jamar, you sure about Uruguay? You good with Uruguay? You sure?
I mean, why not, man? I'm rolling the dice today.
Yes. So Jamar has Uruguay. And so, world, feel free. Let us know who do you think will win the World Cup. Go to the Early Morning Sports Talk podcast community page and follow us. And let us know who you believe will win the World Cup. FYI, over here in Guadeloupe and over here in France, it is going down. People are all in on this World Cup. It's stuff hanging outside, banners, flags, conversations, bars offering discounts, all this stuff, because they want to see France repeat. And so, yes, big, big deal around the world, fellas. Shout out to the United States. I'm very interested in seeing how they do in the World Cup. Right now, we got a young team. I mean, I just want to see them like the Bears. Right now, I want to see what they can do as a young team to develop so that they can be ready for the 2026 World Cup. That's my expectations for the U.S. in this World Cup. And so, Ian, Jamar, bro, before we conclude this weekend and move on with our weekend, any final thoughts or shout-outs as we head into this weekend?
All right, this is, I guess, anti-shout-out. To letting certain athletes on TV, you know, just talking out the side of their neck. I'm referring to LeSean McCoy here. Like, I actually watched the clip. I'm sitting here like, bro, what are you doing? Because apparently, to me, it seems like he's just looking at the stat sheet in the box score, not actually watching the game. For him to just come out here and say that the problem is Justin Fields and wide receivers won't come play with Justin Fields and not actually looking at all the facts in between that. He's playing like this because the offensive line can't hold up. He's also playing like this because the wide receivers can't catch the ball when he throw it to him in the hands. So to come out here and say Justin Fields is the problem and nobody wants to come play with Justin Fields, I mean, hey, I guess that's the reason why, you know, Kansas City didn't even play you when you was on the team, right? Or not to mention, you know, the Bucks and things like that. Look, man, Shady, you had a great career. I did appreciate you in your prime, especially in Philly, but some people just don't need to have a platform, and he's one of them.
Yeah, and your thoughts, bro. Any final thoughts or shout-outs as we head into the weekend?
Jamar took that one from me. He was on point with that one. But I do have a shout out for a Morgan Park Mustang. I believe his name is Chris Durr Jr. He was first team all state as a receiver in 5A. That's pretty impressive to be first team. Especially from a Chicago Public League school. So that's pretty impressive. Shout out to
Chris.
Gotta
be one of the first as maybe his head coach, right?
Yeah, I believe so.
Chris was all state multiple times.
Yeah, I believe so. That's pretty dope.
Yeah, that is dope. Yes. And shout out to the Morgan Park Mustangs. We lost this week in the quarterfinals. But you know, me and Ian and even Jamar are very proud because that hasn't been reached since it was our team, Ian, that made the quarterfinals, and we were there when they made the semifinals as well. And so, shout out to the Morgan Park Mustangs and their program. Once again, y'all, I just want to highlight the World Cup, and I just also want to highlight Nadia and Franc for joining us this morning and talking with us about the World Cup. And so, other than that, everybody, stay safe. Much love to everybody. We thank you all for rocking with us and supporting us on the Early Morning Sports Talk podcast. We do our best every weekend, y'all, to make y'all have a great weekend and have some fun in your weekend and get started with us. So we appreciate the support. We really do. And so other than that, you guys have a great weekend. Be blessed and peace.